The weekend starts on a Friday evening here at London's St Pancras station. Intercity call it their Romance of the Highlands tour. And what you're looking for is not any old commuter train, but the West Highlander, one of their VIP charter fleet. Trains like this normally stand idle at weekends, but it was the growing popularity of short breaks that prompted the launch of these novel rare weekends last year. They are, however, very much weekends for adults rather than children, for people who, once they've got themselves on board, really want to sit down and relax and be looked after until the return on Monday evening. Once out of St Pancras, tonight's route north will take us via Edinburgh to Oban on Scotland's west coast. On the way, the train stops to pick up passengers at St Albans, Leicester and Derby, and then we really get going, crossing the border at about 3 in the morning. In the meantime, however, your maps and guidebooks have to be cleared away so that the table can be laid and you can meet the steward for your carriage.
We'll be covering about 1,700 miles this weekend, which is a lot more than you'd cover comfortably by car. Everyone gets a window seat, that's guaranteed when you book. There are 130 of us on board, and that's not counting the stewards who are looking after us. Drinks are the only extras that you pay for, and the first meal you start with is dinner at the seat, which is your home base for the next 3 days.
After dinner, it's down the corridor to your cabin in the sleeping car. Two bunks and a wash basin provided, a loo at the end of the car, and the rattle of wheels to fall asleep to. Well, the idea of sleeping on a train is more romantic than the rather jolting reality. I don't think I was the only one in need of a strong coffee on Saturday morning. And the stewards also serve bacon and eggs before you reach Oban. Once off the train, there's a new freshness in the air to make you wake up properly. One of the attractions of these weekends is the amount of Scotland you get to see and the amount you're given to eat. Today there's a packed lunch because Saturday's sightseeing is not from the train but a coach and ferry. We're sailing to the island of Mull, largest of the Inner Hebrides group, and it is without doubt one of the most spectacular ferry crossings in Britain. Having a virtually landlocked harbour, Oban is a sheltered little town, but out among the islands, gales can whip up ferociously, one reason why these weekends don't operate in winter. They say you can enjoy, or endure, all four seasons' weather in a single day here. Wrecks litter the Sound of Mull, including one of a Spanish Armada ship, whose officers ended up languishing in the dungeons of Castle Duart. The crossing takes roughly 50 minutes, until the pier was built at Craigie Nure in 1964, visitors to Mull had to be lowered over the side and then rowed ashore. Today, however, it's slightly more modern, and on the quay, coaches are waiting to take everybody, plus what's left of those packed lunches, on a tour of the island. It's deserted moorland virtually all the way, with the occasional seabird the only sign of life. Then there's a 10-minute ferry crossing to the famous little island of Iona, with its abbey and white sand beaches. Saturday night you spend at a hotel in Fort William. Having had dinner on the train as it crossed windswept Rannoch Moor, most people are happy to head straight for a bath and bed. Each room here has its own bath or shower. Sunday morning's breakfast naturally includes porridge made the Scots way with salt. Then it's back to the station for a trip on a steam train. We're off to Mallaig, the little port for ferries to Skye. Now, this package obviously isn't just for rail enthusiasts, but there's no doubt that for many, today's trip proves the highlight of the weekend. You certainly get the feeling the crew are enjoying it too. They call this Scotland's most scenic rail trip. Even the misty weather we encountered couldn't spoil the views, although the chilliness made some passengers wish they'd brought warmer clothes. En route to Mallaig, you pass the first concrete viaduct to be built in Britain, the 100-foot-high Glenfinnan Viaduct, and nearby, the monument to Bonnie Prince Charlie. The train we're on was in constant use from the 30s until British Rail finally abandoned their steam service in 1968. Today it's run and hired out to groups like ours by a Humberside Preservation Group. Incidentally, if you'd like to explore more of Scotland by rail, there's an alternative East Coast weekend that you can join. Late afternoon, and we're back on our own familiar train, swapping stories in the saloon bar before dinner. Well, you certainly get a lot packed into the weekend, and the verdict amongst my fellow passengers is that it's very good value for money. Meals are delicious and you're looked after extremely well. Two tips though: travel light and remember to bring a warm sweater and a raincoat, because although you're in the train most of the time, Scotland can be rather damp and chilly. Apart from that though, all you have to do is sit back and enjoy it.